It's 1980. Karen coming out, being a brand new doctor. Her first assignment, all male prison in Carson City. And she ends up spending the next 30 years there. Boy, do we get into some crazy stuff, man. Hang on. Before we get into all of that, I got a little bit of housekeeping to do. This is one of two types of episodes that I do within the show. 60 to 90 minutes long, got a guest or two on, and the topics range drastically. I love to hear what sets people's soul on fire. And on opposite weeks, it's just me, this microphone, no notes, whatever's in my heart and on my mind. And I just spit into this thing. And those topics, of course, range drastically. And they're about 10 minutes long. Everything you want to know about the show is over on the good old website, BeRawPodcast.com. And that's everything from merch, blogs, where you can listen. You can sign up for the newsletter. You want a little sunshine in your inbox once a month. Check it out, BeRawPodcast.com. Everything I do for this show, I do. I'm a one-man band. I'm asking for a little bit of help. What I would like you to do, jump over whatever platform you're listening to this on, even if another platform you don't listen to it on. Like, 5 stars, review. Each episode really helps. And I'm trying to build up the YouTube community, and I'm almost to 1,000 subscribers. So if you could jump over there, if you haven't yet already, get your friends to do it. And if you like what I'm doing over here, it makes you think, laugh, see something a little different, learn something. You know what? Tell a friend or seven. Speaking of help, I can't get any further without letting you guys know the companies that I use on the regular and have been for quite a while. First up, Composure. These guys make pre-workout. I've used 500-600 milligram pre-workout forever, and I'm cutting that back. This stuff is great. It's like drinking an energy drink, but without all the shit in it. It gives you a little bit of gives you a lot of focus, a little bit of kick in the ass. It's perfect. You know, not just for the gym or working out. If you're going to go into a long meeting, long test at school, those types of things, road trip, it's great stuff. Check that out. Link is in the show notes. These guys, man, you make sure you give them a lot of shit for me when you see them. And then, of course, Liv Rishi. Use the hell out of this stuff. The Rishi Rub is a staple in my gym bag. And then the drops I keep in my nightstand because it helps me sleep at night. So you want to check that stuff out. Link, of course, show notes. Give Charmaine and the crew over there some shit as well for me. And, of course, last but definitely not least, Craig over at High Speed Daddy. This gear that these guys make is amazing. Backpacks, lunch boxes, coolers, some clothing, other stuff for active parenting. As you follow me along, we are very active in this household. But even if you don't have kids, definitely check this stuff out. Get a hold of Craig. Give him hell, of course. All three of these companies, they're local and they're building these communities. And I couldn't be more honored to be part of them. Support small business is always a big thing for me. Check these guys out. All three links are in the show notes. Well, all right, here we go. Karen coming right up. So you can imagine being a female doctor, spending 30 years in an all-male prison. Of course, she went through some shit. There's one scenario that she went through is unimaginable. And we talk about it toward the end of the episode. The positive stuff that she's brought out of spending this much time in the prison system, I commend her. I got goosebumps thinking of it. I commend her for it. And then what she did after she retired from the prison system, well, I'm going to just let her tell you all about that one. Let's get to it. And then everything you say now is on the internet. So if you all got right. Somebody that you want to talk shit about, bring it. I'll make sure we tag them. So I listened to you on another episode or another fellow podcaster. His name is Brian, and he's got Unfiltered Discussions. And, of course, I listened to his stuff. He's a good dude. You should check out his podcast. But when I heard some of your stories, I was like, son of a bitch, I got to talk to this lady because I have questions. And then at the end of the show, what you did after retirement, I was like, are you fucking, what? All right. So I appreciate Brian connecting us, and thanks for coming on. Where are you hailing from?
I live in Carson City, Nevada, which is only 7 miles away from the prison I worked in.
Oh, Carson City. There's some history there, huh?
Yes. And interestingly, Nevada State Prison was the territorial prison. So we had a prison in Nevada before it was actually a state.
Okay. So now is that the prison you worked in at?
I pinched hit there. That was also, let's say, my prison was only 3 miles away from the old prison. So I took care of actually a total of 3 prisons.
Oh, Jesus. And let's see. So the very first prison, and you did some time there.
Yes.
No pun intended. But, well, I guess pun intended. You did some time there. The first one, it was actually built before Nevada became a state?
Yeah.
That's amazing.
1862. And there's great stories about that old prison. And imagine after I retired from 30 years as a prison doctor, they actually sort of pulled me in to be a volunteer prison tour guide because it's now a historical site.
When did it close down as a prison?
2012. So
Holy
it ran from 1862 to 2012.
So how historic, like, did they remodel it to
No. No, no. In fact, you can, if you go there, you'll see that it's in literally a quarry, and in the quarry are like caves or holes. This is where they would throw inmates in solitary confinement. They actually threw them in a cave and just left them there for years.
And okay.
This is in the old days.
Like 1870s, well, like yeah, kind of well, like
or
back
early
then.
Early 1900s.
Oh, no shit. Yeah. Okay, so the prison itself is a freestanding structure.
Right, and it's, the inmates made the prison because the inmates did the quarrying of all the sandstone. So they basically built their...
Yeah, digging your own grave, right?
Correct,
absolutely. That's what I was wondering. So the quarry is, and once the prison was built, did they continue to work in the quarry?
Absolutely. They actually quarried all the stone out. So all the Capitol buildings and state buildings in Carson City, since it's the Capitol, come from that quarry.
Dude, look at the hypocrisy at that, huh?
The hypocrisy, the story is wild. Imagine there was, back in the 1800s, this guy named Abraham Curry, who was a rich guy, miner, rancher, had land, and he wanted the state, the territory to be a state. But what he really wanted was he wanted the capital to be on land he controlled. You understand, right? Of course.
Well, of course.
Right, of course. And then...
What? Wait a minute. This guy was out for monetary gain? I don't believe that. No, I don't believe that.
So he ended up selling the land, 20 acres actually, to build this prison system. But then he also ended up still controlling the quarry. You see what I mean? Right? And... he also became the warden of the place for a while. So that was part of the legal stuff, I'll do this, but then I want to be that. And then I want to get this and money. And
so that's straight up Wild West. Now this was before it was a state.
Before it was a state. And that place historically is fascinating. It's the first state in this country that actually used cyanide gas back in the 1920s.
On who?
They used it, so imagine they had heard about cyanide after the First World War.
Mm-hmm.
And then they decided, we're hanging people in Nevada prison system. Why don't we try something new like lethal gas, cyanide? Why don't we see how this works? So then they needed a guinea pig. And you have guys who are on a death penalty in Nevada, and they picked like the only Asian little guy in the prison at that time, Zhizhong. and he was like 25. And they actually literally used him as a guinea pig to kill him. And, you know, historically, it's a little unclear. It seemed they didn't know what they were doing. Oh, imagine sure. that they didn't have a chamber, an airtight chamber. So then they figure out, okay, we want to use this gas. They took the cyanide liquid, transported it across California with horse and buggy.
Because that's a good idea.
Right, to Nevada. Then they had to aerosolize it. And they didn't know what they were doing. They didn't have an airtight area. So then they thought, let's use the butcher shop because that's a small building and let's put some, you know, stuff around it so the gas doesn't leak out and kill the spectators. Because since it was the first time they ever used lethal gas in the U.S. to kill someone, you know, the army people were there, you know, reporters and
sure. I could see that. Yeah.
And historically, it appears they had to do it twice to kill the young guy. You know, they the first time didn't maybe work so well because the gas in a cold area, what happens? It'll condense. Mm-hmm. So then, you know, then it's on the ground. But Nevada has these unique history of what they did.
So I got to back you up. Imagine. All right. So wonder what they were thinking. Probably cost, right? Because everything comes down to money.
Right.
I imagine. So they probably could get their hands on some gas that's cheap. And they're like, let's build, you know, let's see what this is. Because I mean, hanging's probably not that expensive, but
it's not that heck. That's not expensive.
And like electric, were they? Yeah, they were using electric chairs at that time, well, right?
You know, in Nevada, they never used electrocution for death. They used hanging. Then they went to lethal gas, cyanide, and then in Then in around the late 1980s, they shifted to lethal injection.
Which is not much. That can be crazy too, but we'll get back to that. I got to go back to shipping liquid cyanide. So I assume liquid cyanide is just as bad as like, how does that affect you? Let's make up a scenario.
Let's say it gets on your hands and you do this. You're a goner.
You're gone, right?
Right.
Okay. So imagine this horse and cart coming across the lane and some yahoo decides to rob this thing.
Right. Or dump it in a water supply, which would kill tons of people.
Oh, wow. I didn't even think of that. Yeah. Ooh. At that point, because you don't need much to begin with. So if you take 55 gallons of that shit it would. Yeah. All right. So I used to live in Colorado Springs, and I went to Canyon City and they had a prison museum, and they had a chamber where you could get in and they shut the door.
Right.
And it looks like a big tic tac, I'm a bigger guy and it was a little tight. Man, I tell you what, as soon as they shut that fucking door, I was like, okay, yeah, I can get out. Yeah. And it's one of those where there's a mechanism. The pill was under the seat or something. And then the arm came out and they would tip it and they would drop the pill and it would dissolve. And then the gas would stay inside the capsule.
Yeah.
Yeah. And they had accounts where people, you know, reporters and stuff were writing. It's brutal. It's not like you just fall asleep.
No. You basically,
suffocate, right?
Paralyzes you, you know. I mean, you know, well, it actually, this is what happens is cyanide affects the mitochondria in a cell, which is for cell respiration. So you suffocate, basically.
Yeah.
Like every cell can't do its thing. So
yeah. Oh, how long does it take?
I don't know the exact amount. I will say that when I entered the prison in 1987, and I was put there by the federal government, but 2 years after, and I'm like naive, I'm just like
How old were you at that time?
1987, I was 30. And I was in the prison because in medical school, you know, that's a huge expense. And I came from a poor family. And I did a lot of my education on scholarships. And one of the scholarships was the National Health Corps, which means that the federal government will pay for your medical school, you know, if you qualify and jump through all the stuff in academics. But then in return, you have to work 4 years for them in a place that has no doctor, right, in the United States, sort of like the military, right?
I was just going to say, that's kind of like my nephew's doing that now where,
right,
you know, he's being an EMT, being a medic, so that way when he comes out, but, you know, they're like, you have to serve this long for us, right, to pay for that.
Right. You know? So I had to serve 4 years. Now, I will tell you that on my contract, when I signed it, it was like manpower shortage areas like Indian reservations or inner city. So that's what I thought I would go to. When my time was up in 1987, they looked at me and said, we're going to send you to a male prison. And I didn't even know, you know, I thought that was the oddest thing for them to do.
Now, were you in Nevada? Did you live in Nevada at that time?
Yeah, here's the thing. I was the chief resident for a hospital in Reno. So I had done my specialty training in Nevada, though I come from the Catskill Mountains in New York.
And what? What? Hold on. I'm from upstate New York.
Oh, yeah. Saugerties, which is like right next to Woodstock.
Okay. I'm from Oneida.
Ah, okay.
Outside of Syracuse.
Outside Syracuse,
yep,
yeah.
Yep. Not too far from my childhood home, there's a plaque in the ground that says the geographical center of the state.
Ah, okay.
So when I say I'm from central New York, I am. Well,
you are. That's right, awesome. Back in the middle.
And then when did you move to Nevada?
Well,
for school?
Well, I bounced around. Like at 18, my parents, my mother was German. My father was basically German as well.
Oh.
And so at 18, it was like, okay, you're on your own now. And so I ended up getting scholarships to a college in Massachusetts, Clark University. And then I tried to get into medical school, but couldn't get in the first time because my grades and MCATs and everything were great, but I didn't have anybody pitching for me. In those days, it was incredibly hard to get into med school.
Now, what year was that, 87?
Well, no, 87 is when I did all my finished training. That's when I entered the prison. So I entered medical school 1980. That's a 4-year stint. Then you have 3 years of internal medicine residency. And that 3 years was in Nevada, in Reno.
Now, do you think that you had trouble in those spots because being a woman at that time?
Well, you know, I've always been one of the guys.
Nice.
Okay. I've always been one of the guys. So in med school, you know, only 1 out of 10 people there were females. You know, it's mostly 90% males in medical school in my sure. time period when I was there. So I just hung around with the guys. And then I worked out in the gym with them too, right?
Nice.
And I was always an athlete. In fact, Title IX, you know, hit in the 70s. Mm-hmm. And that was the first time they let girls play interscholastic sports, right, in high school. And I did volleyball, basketball, and track when nice. They opened it up in high school. And then if you're like the first female, and then the guys hate you. My sister and I were both tall blondes, Germans,
nice.
Who my father, we hiked, we hiked, you know, so we were very physical kids. And, but in high school, my sister keeps telling me, I ignored the people, but they kept calling us you fucking white-haired lesbians, lesbos. I didn't even know what that was in those days.
Wait a minute. How do you spell that? I don't even know what that is.
I had no idea what they were talking about. I just thought, well, they're, you know, just bullies. But when I went to college, Clark University is a private, smaller college, a Division III college. And I wanted to play volleyball, and they had no real female sports except for crew and tennis.
Oh, imagine that.
All right. And so I had never really played tennis, and I'd never done crew. Somehow they yanked me into crew. So I was a rower, you know, which is heavy. That's a significant sport.
I'm built to be a rower.
Yeah. So I was rowing, but I loved volleyball. And I tried out for the men's team and made it. And I played collegiate volleyball on the male team when I was in college.
How much shit did you get for that at that time?
Well, you know, fortunately, the men in those days weren't that great. And I had been doing four. They weren't. So I had good ball handling skills, and I had done 4 years in high school with a Polish coach, okay, who was like really a pushy woman. And so I had very good skills, and that's why I made the team.
And a passion for it. That helps. Right, you really like to play.
Right, yeah. Right. And in those days, I could still jump, but women play at in high school, women played at 7'4", men played at 8 feet. So I was really the setter for the team.
Yeah, you sure. See what I mean? Yeah, right. Yeah.
Because I couldn't get significantly up over 8 feet.
How tall are you?
I'm 5'8".
All right. Yeah. You'd have to have quite a vertical to do that.
Yeah, really good vertical. And I could still block intermittently, but it wasn't like the guys, you know.
So like you were more second, third row then probably, right? You're more effective back there.
Well, with you know, being a setter, you're in the front row as a setter.
Right? Oh, okay. So no matter what, you were always in the front row setting.
Yeah, I was in the front row. Okay. So depending on what was going on, I could also jump in. Of course, if the guys on the other team weren't expecting it, you see what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Right. So that was enjoyable to.
Oh yeah, sure.
Stuff that, the
that's
ball
cool.
Back, right.
Yeah.
To stuff the ball back. Yeah.
And that's where that's where you did your medical training. And then for 3 years you went, that's how you got to Nevada.
Right. Yeah. The internal medicine was in Nevada. Right.
Okay.
And I was a chief resident. That means you're in charge of all the other residents.
Sure. And what kind of facility was that in?
Well, at that time it was called WASHA. But it was the hospital for basically Northern Nevada. It was a significant hospital.
Oh, okay. So you saw everything. It's like working in the ER.
I saw everything. I wasn't though prepared for a prison. That's the thing. It's just
different world. At that time. So what year was that? Then 82 again, right?
Well,
you were.
So from, what was it, 84 to 87, I was in the hospital in Reno, you know, 84. Working as getting the specialty degree. In 87, I walk into the prison, 1987.
So when you were in the hospital at that time, were they still smoking in the hospital?
In the VA, they were. Because I also worked in the veterans hospital, the big veterans hospital in Reno. Oh, my God.
Them old coots, man, you ain't going to get them cigarettes away from them guys. They don't give a shit.
They're
on the downslope. They were.
I had one guy in that hospital that still gives me the willies.
In the VA hospital?
This is the VA hospital. Yeah. He had what's known as Berger's disease, which is, let's just say, the vessels to all his body parts were bad to begin with, and smoking just clamped him down. So when I met him, he had both legs amputated and one arm amputated because of smoking and his underlying horrible vascular disease. So he had one arm left.
Hey,
and he was still smoking with this one arm. And it's like, oh my
God. Oh, come on, man. Hey.
That was too much for me. I mean, I don't know.
I don't know, man. I don't know. I see a guy like that, and he's lived a life, and he did what he'd wanted to do probably pretty much his whole life. Right. he's on the downslope. Let's give him a cigarette.
I mean, he was going to die no matter what, but it just, it gave me the willies just watching him and then realizing he's lost all of this. And
from that.
And cigarettes. That's the thing, cigarettes. And, you know, he was a Second World War vet. And of course, in the Second World War, the vets actually had nicotine, you know, put in their ration packs because it reduced basically hunger, you know, and for something for them to do. So,
and stress too, right? Yeah. His disease, is that something from wartime or was that
that's genetic. Genetic. He had a vascular disease. Yeah.
Damn. And then, so here you are, chief resident.
Yes.
And then all of a sudden, they like call you up and you're like, they're like, time to go.
Time to go. Yep. Time to go.
So when you read this letter where you're like, what the fuck?
Yeah, it was interesting because, you know, looking back at it, they had three possible people they wanted. Okay. So in this residency group that I was in, two of the other people that were there in the group also were national health people. You see what I mean? National health.
So they're in the same kind of situation Same
situation as me. So one was a black guy, one was a Hispanic guy, and then there was me. Okay. So they said, okay, we want you three to go to the prison and be interviewed. Well, they interviewed us, and then the black guy and the Hispanic guy goes, absolutely not. No way in hell am I going to work in the prison.
No shit?
Yeah. And then because the Hispanic guy wanted to go to California, and, you know, that was him. And the black guy was like, prisons, no.
This don't go together.
So then they were left with a tall blonde, right.
Like, who thought that was a good idea? Was the warden like, good luck?
Well, the thing is, it's the National Health Corps that puts you there. And then the imagine in a prison, it's like a military structure. So you have a prison director on the top who's in charge of all the wardens at each prison in the state.
Okay.
And the prison director is responsible only to the governor. Now, at that time, the governor at that time was under huge lawsuits because the inmates were suing the prison for not giving medical care. Mm. And what most people in the United States do not know is that inmates, after the Supreme Court decision in 1976, okay, so there was a court case called Estelle versus Gamble, very famous in the Supreme Court, where the Supreme Court in 1976 said, if someone is incarcerated in a prison, all right, incarcerated, so they can't leave, they have a right to medical access if it's a serious medical need, and that prisons cannot be indifferent. So up to 1976, half the prisons in our country really didn't have medical care, and wardens were just letting people die.
Okay. Hold on. Okay. Hold on. I have questions. We got to back this up. So 76 is the point.
76 is the point where inmates had a constitutional right to get health care for a serious medical need. Yes.
Now, let's start there.
Yep.
Before I back up.
Yep.
So what constitutes serious?
Well, that is interesting because the Supreme Court, you know, used that word. That means, like, if you have a guy who broke his arm and the bone's sticking out and you just ignore it, not acceptable. If you have someone who, let's say, has an appendicitis, a horrible, you know, it's like, and you ignore them and it ruptures and they die. So what happened, I mean, so serious is you know, an average person in the outside world, they know what's serious. If you have a kid, right, and they're writhing around in horrible belly pain, you don't say, too bad, we're just going to ignore you. You actually right. need to be medically evaluated, right?
Yeah. Like, this is, I mean,
then you have a sniffle and you're like, bah, bah, bah. That's not it, but it's serious medical need. And up to that point, really, wardens were the ones who controlled who got medical care and who didn't.
Oh, I can't even imagine.
Yes. Well,
oh,
right.
That's
why the Supreme Court in 76, you know, they had, there was enough stuff coming out about prisons. You know, usually in the early days, people just ignored prisons, you know, like, you know,
ship you off, you're done, see ya. Yeah.
Right. But in the 70s, late 70s, prison rates started to really climb up. And then you get more of this kickback where it became more and more egregious, you know, horrible, where families were like, oh my God, my son went in, he had this, and then they just ignored him and he died, and they complained. But, you know, what do you do? After a while, though, the Supreme Court finally realizes, oh, wait a second, this is a problem. And they made the decision to use one of these cases as a precedent.
So that case that you mentioned earlier, that mm-hmm. was the turning point. So yes, they said, right. okay, let's take, now what was the serious case? Like, what happened in that case on the medical right, front?
Yeah, and see, that's what's wild. The Estelle versus Gamble had to do with a guy who had a back issue, a bad back issue. But they used that particular case. It wasn't like some guy who had, bones sticking out of him or
his appendix broke or something.
They didn't use that. They used okay. this case. They, you know, the court systems, I don't know why, but they used that case to put it on the books.
Somebody knew somebody.
That's right. Once it's, you know, an amendment to the Constitution, then you open the door where lawyers can get involved. And once you get lawyers involved, then there's lawsuits.
Yeah.
Nevada then came under significant lawsuits for not giving medical care. And Nevada had one of these habits where they paid very poorly. So no, let's say, legitimate doctor is like, oh, I want to go to prison and earn only 25% of what a normal doctor would work and live and work in a dangerous, smelly, icky, violent.
And deal with some major shit, right?
No, they didn't want to do that. So they couldn't really get doctors.
Okay.
Now, what I didn't know when I started, because there were some early doctors floating around, I didn't know this, but when the state legislatures realized, well, how do we can't force a doc. How about this? Let's say we've got a doctor in the community and we stripped him of his medical license because he's
malpractice or something. Yeah.
Or sell something bad. You know, they stripped a license. Then they change the little rule that says, okay, you can't practice in the state except in the prison.
Oh.
You see what I mean?
Okay. So going back to the lawyer thing, that probably opened up a ton of shit for lawyers.
Oh God. Yes.
My God.
All right. And then, so when this is just a story, when I get into the prison, I hear about a prior doctor. Okay. Now, he's dead a long time, so I can say his name too, but it doesn't matter. But just think of this old doctor who they stripped the license of, and then I hear about him. I'll just say, I'll call him Dr. R. So Dr. R, he obviously had lost his mind because the inmates and the warden there said, well, you know, the other doc we had, he kept talking to an imaginary parrot on his shoulder. Really, really. and they said, you know, the one damn thing about that parrot, the warden said, parrot kept telling him, I think you should do a rectal exam to figure it out on the guy.
That's amazing. That is hey, the parrot said bend over, bro.
I know, right. So anyway, when I first heard this, you know, I thought they were pulling my leg.
No, yeah, yeah. No shit.
Then I realized that, you know, this guy was who knows what, schizophrenic or demented or who knows what, but they allowed him to go in. And in Nevada, this was into the mid-90s, because when they built the Supermax prison in the northern, well, sort of eastern part of the state called Ely prison had a doctor who had, you know, a ding on his license, okay? Because nobody wanted to work up there. That's a
Supermax.
Right. And plus, there's nothing there. You know, there's like a mining town. I mean, there's hardly any people there. So, well,
isn't that why you put a prison there? Because there's nothing there?
Yeah, well, that's, you know, to have people have jobs. But medical people are not, you know, custody officers. Custody officers only need a high school education. That's it. Nothing else.
Yeah.
Right. So they will work and get a state salary and a retirement. So they'll do that. But not professional medical people want to go to a place out in boonie land and get not paid that well.
Right.
That guy, that doctor, they called me and said, hey, we got this guy, inmate, who has a severe femur fracture and he's in ungodly pain. And we need to give him some pain medicine. And I said, well, you've got the doc up there. They said, he can't prescribe narcotics. I said, what do you mean he can't prescribe narcotics for pain? And then I find out, because I asked the director, why do we have a guy up there who why doesn't he have a narcotic license? They go, well, they took it away because he only gave care to female patients if they gave him sex in the outside world. Okay? And I think this guy is working up there, right? So this was so out of my realm, you're learning about all this stuff.
But the thing is, though, that's human beings, right? Anytime you get in a situation like that, and you give them the opportunity to take advantage of somebody that's vulnerable, and now patients are vulnerable because now they're in a prison, right. So they're limited to what they can do. Of course, people are going to take advantage of that. Ugh. Yeah. Anyway, yeah. Wait a minute, though. So
I'm going off on all these weird stories.
That's amazing, though. Let's just talk stories, because these are great stories. But you... So get back on track, because I know some shit when you got started.
Yes, very much so.
So when you started this prison, like, what was going through your head? Like, holy shit, like driving to this thing for the first day, I have a 300 ring circus of an imagination.
Right, yeah.
So I can go forever. Yeah, like, right. What were you thinking when you,
when I pulled up to the place? The thing that I still remember more than anything was when I got out, I just smelled a ton of bad manure. And I didn't realize it at the time, but they had a dairy sort of ranch right next to it. But, you know, so my first thought was, oh my God, I smell shit. You know, this is my first thought.
Yeah. Right? Not what the prisoners ran, the little farm?
Yeah, they had, they also had a, what's known as a minimum security camp next to my facility. Mm-hmm. And these are minimum guys. So they work with the forestry people, you know, they work with slash and burn. They were taking care of the cows. They take care of the alfalfa fields all around the prison. Sure. You know, so that's a whole different area. But when I first walked in, I was nervous because I'm not used to this security stuff. You know, you see the prison with all the double fence lines, the barbed wire, you know, and then you go through what's known as a gatehouse. So I go in there, and then there's a custody officer. And I said, I'm Dr. Gedney. He goes, who are you? You know, it's like, you're not on my list. You're not on my list. And then I start panicking, like, oh my God, this is where they told me to go. You know, am I on the wrong spot? But he was, I still remember, he was not pleasant, you know, like, what is this person coming in? I don't know. And so I said,
was he like an old dude that's been there for 50 years?
Yes, he was an old guy, and I don't think he was expecting a female doctor to come in. This is going to be a pain.
Yeah, and if the wind blew the wrong direction, he got all pissed off as like one of those dudes?
Right, yes.
I can picture him.
I felt, let's just say, I felt very unwanted at that moment.
Sure.
And then finally, I convinced him that I really was supposed to be here. And then he called, I don't know, the warden's office, or he called somebody. And then they said, yeah, whatever they said. He goes, go through that, you know, gate. And then they sort of buzz you in.
They don't tell me nothing. I don't know. I work with people like that.
Yeah, then they buzz you in. And then you have to walk out to another area. And you realize, okay, now I have to go to this other building, and that's more gates. And then you hear these gates clang behind you. There's nothing like those iron gates, you know, the clang sound.
Yeah.
And then I walk into an area where there's a couple of custody officers smoking like chimneys, right? Like it's like,
yeah.
And I come in. And they're looking at me, and I said, well, I'm the doctor. The medical clinic's over there. You know, no one actually took me or did anything. They just were smoking, drinking their coffee, and they hit a buzzer, and then another gate opened, and then I went that way. And then I get into this is the early days, because they didn't have the big medical facility, which I ran. They built that in the early 90s. So this is a small medical clinic. They have 20 beds for inmates, and they have like an x-ray room, a treatment room, the little pharmacy room, a little tiny place, a culinary to get some food. So imagine I come in, and then there's this nurse. In my book, I sort of look at her as a Cruella de Vil. She's got the white starched uniform on, the red long nails like claws. She's sort of skinny. She's got white hair that's all permed. And she looks at me, and I said, well, I'm Dr. Gedney. I have to do my meds. Or like, she was like not happy about it at all. So like, in the medical world, you know, if a doctor shows up, I'm used to people and nurses where they're, oh, let's show you here. This was like.
But how long was she running that?
Oh, clinic? Yeah, she was running. I didn't know. I was naive. I didn't know. I was sort of mucking up her power thing.
I was just going to say, you were taking away her power, and she probably had some side shit going on too.
Right, right.
No, so absolutely. Absolutely.
And then. Yeah. And then she pointed at this guy who's like in a blue scrub suit and says, he'll show you around. He'll show you where your office is. I'm like, okay. So I follow him, right? And he shows me where my office is, at this long hallway at the end, you know.
So like, you had to go by like all the beds and stuff to get to your office?
No, actually that led to it. So the hallway goes down, and to the left is my office, and opposite my area is a treatment room, and then to get to the beds, you have to walk through another door system sideways, and then you go back to the other part of the building where there are these rooms with like one or two beds in each room, and they only have two bathrooms for, you know, 20 guys, and they're sick. So that doesn't
work. That's disgusting.
I know. But
if you have 20 beds, how many inmates were in the prison at that time?
The yard at that time was probably about 1,500 inmates.
Whew! And you had 20 beds.
That had 20 beds for, you know, really sick guys or like really old guys who were like too infirm to do anything, you know.
Well, they're kind of like a hospice at that point, right?
Well, right. Yeah. Yeah. No, you get shit. Like a 85-year-old who really can't walk and really can't take care of himself. You can't put him on a prison yard, you know, with all these young guys. They just take everything from him, you know.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And then he can't even get to the culinary in time. You know, they got a big culinary.
Yeah.
So you have to come out of the unit and get there. All the young guys run quickly. The guy never gets to eat. It's a nightmare. And so, all right. But the kicker is this guy in the scrub shoe shows me around, and he's the only one who seems pleasant to me. Like, oh yeah, here, this is that. Da, da, da. So after the little tour he gives me, we come out into the hallway, and then this big guy with a mustache who turns out to be a physician assistant from the military. You know, they had a PA. They didn't have a doctor at that time. He was a physician assistant. Big, big guy. I mean, probably 6'4", heavy, with a big mustache thing going on.
Right out of the Wild West, huh?
Yeah, right. But he looks at me, and he basically says, "What the hell are you doing?" And I was like, I didn't know if he was yelling at me or the guy in the blue scrub suit. And then he goes, "What are you doing with that fucking chomo?" And I go, I didn't know what a chomo was. Do you know what that means?
Well, that's a slang for a Mexican dude, right?
No. In the prison, chomo means child molester.
Oh, now, I didn't know now. That. Oh, chomo.
And the nurse, no one told, the nurse didn't tell me that I'm being led around by
a child molester?
I don't care if they're a child molester. I'm not a child. But I didn't.
Well, the thing is, I always say a child molester belongs in the wood chipper. But
yeah, but if you understand, I didn't even know the
yeah.
term.
Well, yeah, sure.
And but to have a new person where you go, just follow this guy, and you don't tell him that that person's an inmate.
That seems
so unprofessional to me.
Well, a lot of this seems
right. So I was struck by the unprofessional stuff going on. That's the thing.
Mm-hmm.
And it's interesting. So in the prison yard, you can imagine there's things that happen, right? You know, like they stab or they whatever, they do bad things. And so they would have what's called a man down, where you have to go to the yard. And that was something nurses always did with a inmate like porter, like, you know, an inmate and a nurse would go quickly to like basically put a guy on a stretcher and bring him back. You know what I mean?
So you wouldn't go to a man down?
No, I didn't go to a man down because.
Is that because like your value? Like you're more value?
One is that, but also it's sort of like, do you take your only doc out of your little hospital to go racing out in a yard where what you really need is just somebody to bring the inmate back? You see what I mean?
Yeah, makes sense. Yep.
See, that's how they looked at it. And here's another thing that I have to share. You know, first of all, this is such a male environment. Like nurses can be female, that's not a problem, but a doctor, someone who can give orders, someone custody has to deal with, they did not like that. And then plus, because I cared about the inmates, I cared about my patients. You know, if someone's sick, I care about them. Right. They don't.
That's not cool.
That's not cool. That's like,
so. Yeah. But the thing is, the hierarchy is the word that comes to mind. Were you above, like you could order the guards around? Like you could say, bring him here or do this or move him? Could you?
I could say we need, like an example, this is typical. You know, say you get a guy who I can stabilize him, but they have to go to the hospital. Okay. Then I tell custody, this guy, we need, you know, 911. We have to send him to the hospital. He's not going to make it. And then they would look at me and go, Well, can't we wait till it's the next shift? No, we can't wait till it's the next shift.
It's amazing.
Stuff like that was like so. I was out of my element, and on top of it, you know, there's that sexism going on.
Oh, I can't even.
But on top of that, my husband was black. Okay.
Jesus, woman, you're just asking to get your ass kicked.
I know.
Wait a minute. Let's just do a quick recap.
Yeah.
You're a female doctor.
Right.
In a prison in the 80s.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. In Carson City, there was no black people in the city at that time.
Wait a minute. Let me hold on. Right, back up. Let's recap. Here you are, a female doctor in an all-male prison.
Yes.
Out in the Wild West where no black people are.
Correct.
And you're married to a black dude.
Yeah, yes.
I got to laugh at you because, like,
it's like you can't get wild. I mean, you can't get wilder than what I lived through. I mean,
I wouldn't have made that up.
I know.
Yeah, right? All right, so now you've started this, and you're getting going. Mm-hmm. What's the first thing that, like, just, I guess, horrible happened? Okay, wait a minute. Hold on.
I'm going to jump to the most horrible thing that happened to me early in my career.
But real quick, before we get to that, what's the absolute worst injury that you've seen?
Okay, the worst one was there was a guy in our prison who, and it's a horrible story, sad story. He had given evidence at another prison, the Nevada State Prison, the historical one. So imagine this guy was a white guy, right? He's at that prison, and Aryan warriors had killed a black guy. Okay. All right. Now, somehow he had given evidence to the attorney generals about what happened. And then he wanted to be protected, right? And they said, we'll protect you, right?
Rightly so.
All right. Well, they didn't. What they did was they sent him to my facility, and you know, there's the grapevine business going on, and there's never any, what should I say, security, really. So they had a death warrant out for him, the AWs, okay? So what they did was they somehow stole gasoline, you know, and then they put sugar in there, and then in a balloon, and then they lit it on fire, and it threw it at the guy. And he went up like napalm. So he burned.
What's a sugar? What's a sugar do?
It sticks.
Okay. So I was thinking of that, but I wanted to make sure.
Yeah. So it sticks.
Like out in the middle of the yard, they just threw it at him.
Yeah, they threw it at him. And, you know, see, he burnt from probably the neck to the knees. And he was, and of course, he went to a burn unit in Las Vegas, 2 years in a burn unit.
Holy shit.
Yeah. And then when he came back, because that was really a real, you know, I don't know all the particulars, but that is not acceptable. Okay. And so, cause they didn't protect him.
Yeah.
And so when he came back, he still had that death thing on him, you know, they don't give up, right? So
he was still alive.
Right. So they shipped him to another prison.
Okay.
And then years later, because he had so many medical problems, the state he was in basically convinced Nevada to take him back. So by then he came back to me. And we had to have him what's called walk alone, house alone. So they put him in a cell in my medical facility, which is double, you know, sort of gates, actually 1, 2, 3 gates to get through to even get near him. But in essence, he was isolated his entire last years in my infirmary, tied to oxygen too, because that burn and the breathing,
yeah, you can't.
Garbage, he toasted his lungs too. Yeah.
And then he passed away by.
Yeah, he passed like away because his lungs basically gave out, and he got into a tremendous like pneumonia and everything, and we couldn't. He needed a ventilator, and that's not going to happen in the prison. We sent him out to see if they could stabilize him, but he died. You know.
Oh God, that's horrible. Just living that way, like being conscious and like. Knowing what state you're in.
Yeah, yeah.
So then.
Burns affect me the most. That's, you know, especially those type of burns. That's like, ooh.
And then living like that and then send them back. Holy Christ, Jesus. Yeah. So then let me ask you this. What's an example of when something happened to a dude and you helped him out and you felt really good about it? Like, you're like, this is why I'm a doctor.
Yeah, well, that's so many stories. so many stories. Well, I think the best ones for me are you have a prison, you know, because we have multiple prisons, right? But I was the senior physician for the state, you know, like I'm because my not only the years I was there, I have unique skill level because in my training, I did a lot of chemotherapy. So the cancer guys got sent to me. We did all the chemotherapy inside my prison because I had that training. Plus I sat on the cancer tumor board for the hospital in Carson as well. So I worked with a major oncologist. And so the thing is I would get guys sent up to me where the doc would go, something's wrong with him. I don't know. And then I would diagnose, he's got cancer.
And just a variety of different cancers, right?
Yeah, they're all different types of cancer. But I would say that when other prisons labeled a guy like a malingerer or an asshole, and they were fed up with him and they sent him to me, and then I found out something truly, truly wrong that I could fix and that I saved his life. And if he had stayed at the other prison, he'd be dead.
Dead.
Right. Those are the cases.
Yeah. And that's like, that's why I became a doctor to have that ability. Right. That's cool. Even though they're in prison and stuff, man, he still got to have medical care.
Right. Right. And then some guys are just, there are all different reasons why guys end up in prison. And a lot of it is, you know, I had no conception of like who ends up in prison, but since you're there 30 years, you know, I could see a 20-year-old guy come in and then I'm still taking care of him at 50. You see what I mean?
Yeah.
And I really know them. And this is just an example. Like there was this 17-year-old boy. Okay. Because I took care of him for cancer. So he was 17. And his story was, and they committed him as an adult at 17 and put him in my adult prison. But at 17, his father was raping his little sister. Okay. All right. So what happens is when the father goes out, he ends up killing the father. And taking his wallet, okay?
Okay.
So at 17, he gets life in prison. Okay. Now, and then he got cancer, which I took care of.
How old was he when he got cancer?
He got cancer, let's see, he got cancer probably in his 30s. In his 30s. And then he got a secondary cancer, two cancers. It's like, and you know, when you find out the backstories, you go, oh God, this is just what a miserable world. Because what I saw is you have families that are whatever, you know, criminal families or mentally ill families, and then you get a kid in the mix, and then you, I think to myself, how many kids could actually turn out okay in those families? You see what I developed a very different feel. Like I had one of my guys, one of the things that saved me to just do medicine all the time, that wouldn't have worked for me because it's very depressing. You know, there's only so much you can do for an inmate in the prison, you know, medical wise.
Right, right.
And then you're constantly swimming upstream because the environment doesn't really help you. You know, in fact, they are mad at you when you want to give care. Mm-hmm. The thing that I did was I realized so many of these guys, what they really needed was life skill courses that could help them, that if they did leave, you know, would do better. Where they needed stress management, anger management, relationships, how to deal with addiction. So I ended up, as a volunteer in the evening, developing my own little life skill courses. And then I got the prison to give them credit for it so they could get a little time off their sentence, because you need a carrot to bring guys in.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, of course.
You need a carrot for that. Aye. And it actually started initially with a guy in the other prison, Nevada State Prison, where this guy was a military vet, and he wrote a grant to the Bureau of Alcohol and Drug Abuse to help with addiction. You see, it was an inmate.
An inmate
wrote a grant, and a psychologist helped him get it. And then
that's amazing.
Right. And this guy, that was wonderful. And this poor guy was in prison because somehow his baby fell over and clocked their head. And then he was, you know, charged with the death of the child. Right. So it's
no
like,
shit.
Yeah. And this is in the days of the shaken baby syndrome, where they were really going a bit bonkers.
Yeah. Make an example. Right, so. Yeah. I have a quick story for you, because you're talking about the 17-year-old kid that came to prison as an adult. Long time ago, and when I was living in Colorado, I was on the road a lot for my job. And this is back before Audible, right? Mm-hmm. Before books on, you know, we could get them on your phone. And when I first started, it was on tape, right? Then they went to books on CD.
Right.
And I would go to the public library, and you could take out 5 books at a time on CD. So I wouldn't even look, because at that time, my library only had one aisle, I guess, of books on CD. So I would walk down one side and just randomly pick 5 books on CD, because I'm on the road, and I'm like, in a lot of these books on CD, there was like 14 CDs for the book, because they're long.
Yeah, right, because they're so long. Sure. Yeah.
And if I didn't like it, I just, because I was home every night, right? Yeah. I wasn't on the road, like, pew, pew, over the road. So if I didn't like it, I just put it back and tried the next one. And it worked really well, because I found a lot of cool stuff, right, that I wouldn't have picked if I was, like, physically looking at titles, right? And I found this one. It was an autobiography, and the guy read it too, where he was charged at 17 with the murder, and it's all cliche stuff, with the murder of the cheerleader.
Mm-hmm.
And because everybody knew he had a crush on her, and he was kind of the nerd.
Right.
And she was dating the football star. She ends up murdered. They pin him for it. Goes to an adult prison at 17.
Yeah.
And for the first couple chapters, he gets extremely graphic of his first 2 years in prison.
Because they're molested.
And he goes, out of the first 2 years in my, I'm not going to get into the detail because need to. But one thing that got me was that for 6 months, he was in the infirmary on his belly, laying in a like a gurney
right.
kind of thing with his face sticking out, you know, yeah. because he was raped so hard and so fast and stuff. He couldn't sit down. It was he was just torn apart.
Yeah. Because it tears the rectum and
it was. Yeah. And he again, he gets graphic about. But so then he talks about and it's funny and not fun, funny, but yeah. it's cool that you talked about reform and stuff like that, because when he was after a couple of years, it died down and nobody kind of paid attention to him anymore.
Yeah.
And then he started going to school for law because yeah. he's like, I didn't kill this lady.
Right.
I knew I didn't kill her, you know, this, that, yeah. and the other. Then he started mentoring people to read and write. So that's what he did.
Yeah.
Right. So I thought, you know, I was like, oh, okay, cool. So he gets out. Mm-hmm. Through his law stuff, they get the case reopened. Find out quickly because of the advancement of technology DNA and DNA and all that. Well, because he was in for like 22 years or something.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Find out quickly that it was the football star that did it.
Yeah.
Right. So they know they found him. They go to arrest him and he hung himself in his garage.
Yeah.
And the guy ended the book going like, this piece of shit knew that he was going to jail and couldn't deal with it. So he took the easy way out and I had to deal with that for 22, you know, and
right.
He wasn't like yelling mad at it. He was just calmly. And he's like, I get it. Things happen. And he was compensated and all that. But but it just reminded me of that when you said that 17-year-old kid came, I can't even imagine the shit that he dealt with.
And it's a very strange dynamic because you can imagine a 17-year-old in the prison and they're traumatized and they still want to be tough, but they're still a kid, right? And then you have someone like me who cares about them and they like latch on to me. You know what I mean?
Oh, right? I can totally see that.
You see that? So, and then it's, you know, that emotional dynamics is very, it's tricky because, you know, I want to care for them, but I don't want them to attach too much to me either.
Yeah.
So, but it's a different world.
Yeah. It's brutal. Yeah. All right. So what's the worst thing to happen to you? We got to get into that.
We got to get the worst thing to happen. Well, yeah, this is, this is something that does not happen often to prison doctors, but happened to me.
Because everybody wants to know, listen, and be like, she had to get into some shit. We need to know about it.
Yeah, this was sort of wild. But first, to understand that because I had a black husband, the racial sort of things in the prison were weird with custody. Okay. So custody didn't like me for different reasons, but one of them was also because I was married to a black.
When you say custody, you're talking like the guards?
Yeah, the guards.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
The guards who were very much the good old boy system.
In the '80s.
In the '80s, right.
Out west. Oh, Christ. Yes, oh.
Right. So what happens is I end up, and so I'll start October Friday the 13th.
Of course.
1989. I go into my, office, and I had been seeing a number of different inmates, but one particular inmate was a military vet. He was a Marine. His name was Kenneth Meller. And in the prison, they would call him Moth. And I thought maybe they called him Moth because he had sort of gray, fuzzy hair and he smoked like a fiend. So even his face was gray. You know what I mean? I mean, that's how much nicotine was like.
Oh,
a chain smoker. Oh. And so
What was he in for?
He was famous. He killed the first highway patrolman in Nevada, Gary Gifford.
In some circles, that's a big deal.
Well, in Nevada, it was a big deal because it was the first, you know, highway patrol guy in Nevada who got killed. And so he actually was put on death row. Okay. But then the Supreme Court, a few years later, it was in the 70s, the Supreme Court for a while made the death penalty unconstitutional. So guys who were on death row became life with no possibility of parole.
Ugh, okay.
All right, so that was him. And because he had been in prison and had been in prison for 14 years and hadn't, you know, been violent in the prison, he was in my prison, which is considered a medium security prison.
Okay.
Then he sees me for problems, and in essence, he becomes sort of like fatally attracted to me or something.
Oh, no. Okay.
Yes, bad stuff. And here I am naive, and I'm trying to figure out, okay, and this happens sometimes with, you know, patients where they look at you too much for whatever. And I had one guy before him who got too attached to me. Plus, he wasn't right in the mind. He thought I was his, like, ex-wife, and I was cheating on him. He was, like, mentally ill. And I knew he had issues. So I told custody. Now, what custody should have done is what they did was just beat him to a pulp. You know, they sometimes like, you know, and this guy's mentally ill. And then they beat him up. They threw him into Nevada State Prison. And then he went Looney Tunes and broke the jaw of one of my nurses. Okay. So here I am now in another predicament with this guy is getting too close to me. But I think that I can handle it. Like, you know, all right. That was a mistake.
Yeah. Hindsight.
Right. And I didn't tell custody about this because to me, they overreact. And this guy was not mentally ill. He was actually highly intelligent. Ooh. And which is not good actually for me. But when.
Well, what do they say? Fine line between psycho and genius,
yeah,
right?
Inside and very brilliant. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And my husband, you know, I told my husband, I said, I don't know, this guy's, you know, and my husband said, Karen, he's a Bush vet. And I said, well, what's that? Because my husband was a platoon leader in Vietnam. This guy had been in Vietnam. I felt sort of bad for him, right? You know, too, right?
Yeah, sure.
To me, it was like, okay, he's a little bit screwed up because of the war. And my husband said to me, look, a Bush vet is a guy who has never come back from the war. He's dangerous. Be careful. Yeah, well, I tried to be careful, but when he came in that day, imagine he comes in with a brown paper bag. Now, in that bag, I didn't know this at that time, in that brown paper bag was a buck knife, not a shiv, not a make-believe knife, a real buck knife. He had brought in the bag was these ropes made out of torn up t-shirts, junior mints, and a carton Camel cigarettes and marijuana. Mind you, he brings in this bag, you know, when inmates come into a medical infirmary in those days, they didn't check what they were bringing in. You know, the security was okay.
Yeah. Right.
Okay. So he comes in with his bag and he sits down and he looks at me. He goes, you know what day it is today? And I said,
oh, no.
Yeah. I said, Friday the 13th. And then my fur goes up on the back of my neck. Right.
Yeah.
And he goes, and that's the day you're going to watch me die. And like,
What? Yeah, I'm sorry. You said what?
Right. So I got up to get out of my room. You know, it was like a reflex. And then he went, you know, like my neck, you know, he did one of those neck things where you like head's supposed to snap off. But because I'm athletic,
he tried to break your neck.
That's what it felt like. Well, he didn't want me to leave the room. So holy, that was like a reflex on him. But so my neck went in my whole body. Oh, like I did literally a somersault over my big desk, you know, and landed on the other side because the force, I went with the force, you know, you're used to going with the force.
Right.
So I landed, but I landed weirdly on my wrist, and I thought I broke my wrist. And then he slams this big, heavy wooden desk, you know, into me. And then he's standing there yelling, because this is now a commotion, right? And the assistant warden, who is not that far away from this long hallway, because that's medical, and then that's where the assistant warden with all the smokers are. Well, that guy really doesn't like me, okay? Because he's married to the director of nursing, so they were very nepotistic.
Yeah.
All right, yep. So the inmates yelling down the hall, and I hear that assistant warden going, "What the fuck going on?" You know, that sort of stuff. Yeah. And I'm like in like shock and squished. And so the inmate yells down, "Give me that jug of water," because the assistant warden is walking past the pharmacy area where there's this big jug of water. I don't know. So why he even said that, but as I'm trying to get up, you know, like see what's going on, I see the assistant warden just hand him the jug, and the inmate shoves the door closed and locks it. Okay. Locks it from the inside. The prison is so bad. They didn't even know if they had a key to that door because it's not like, you know, a security world.
And there's no windows or nothing. So it's a fucking solid room with a solid door.
So now we got the solid door. Now my room is at the end, and I have actually windows on the side, but they're the safety glass windows with the wiry things through it.
You ain't going through that.
Right. And then the inmate, like, plastered, because he's a vet. He knows what he's doing, you know. So he plastered paper all through the window so you couldn't look in. Okay. And because he bought the ropes things, he even roped the handle to the I don't know, metal housing thingy on the side, which was an electrical system, you know, so even if they had tried to get in, they weren't going to get in very well. You see what I mean?
So he tied the door shut from the inside.
Yeah, from the inside. Okay.
Jesus, dude. God,
right. Okay. Right. So he had everything all planned. Right. And so then, of course, like, I'm in shock.
Oof.
And now I'm held hostage, and the prison doesn't really negotiate with hostage people. You see what I mean?
No. Yeah.
Right. So, and I'm just like, my adrenaline's going like this, right?
Oh, I can't
move. Like a, going like this. And this whole ordeal lasted 10 hours. Okay. So what happened is he's like basically letting me know, I'm going to fuck you dead or alive. Okay. All right. So I chose alive.
Well, I would go with that too.
Right. Okay. But the thing is, my mind is, you know, I'm in this position where I'm like, I can take him, you know, if I get a drop on him. And then I'm thinking, what are you, crazy? He's a Marine vet. He's bigger. Yeah, he outweighs you. He has a buck knife.
He's crazy.
He's crazy. And so this whole tension goes on, and it's sort of 4 hours into the hostage deal where he does it. And the thing is, the thing for me, because everybody's different, I made the decision, I wanted to be in control, okay? So okay. It was like, okay, you know, when he does it, I'm not going to move. I'm not going to I'm not going to say anything. I'm not going to make a squeak. And actually, I was on the floor at that time, and I'm looking under you know, the exam table, and I see these little dust bunnies and dirt and stuff. So
I just focused on that.
So I like literally dissociated my body and my brain. And then when it was over, the energy in the room, well, the energy for him, but for me, this horrible energy went down like this, right? Because, and then he starts smoking cigarettes. Oh. And he had brought marijuana with him. He smoked a joint. Oh, my God.
In a closed room like that.
In a closed room with me, and I hate smoke. I absolutely hate it.
Oh, okay. God.
And so then they had called in a negotiator. And you can't make this up. The negotiator they got was the sheriff, and that's Kenny Furlong in Carson City. Turns out the sheriff was the boyhood friend of the inmate.
So the inmate was from Carson City.
Yes, he was originally from Carson City.
Oh, yeah. Jesus Christ.
Okay. And now the sheriff, he tried, but you know, I found out from their conversation and stuff, they had been boyhood friends. And, you know, the inmate, Meller, was basically saying, Kenny, you can't do anything. Leave me alone. Ba, 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 ba. You see what I mean?
Yeah.
And of course, the sheriff guy is trying to talk him out of it. That didn't work. But later, after the hostage situation, the sheriff talked to me. And that's when I found out. He said, yeah, we were a bunch of guys, half became cops, half became criminals. You know, so.
Yeah, yeah. Criminals went to Vietnam and.
Yeah, yeah. And then, and so all this time starts going like, oh my, they, you know, they'll intermittently call, then they don't call. Then it was freezing because it's October. And I didn't know this. I thought my temperature was getting off. They had closed down the heat. Then it was really cold at that time, you know, so my room's like an ice box.
Why would they do that? Try to get him out of there?
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, but they stopped the heat, so I'm freezing. And you know, the only thing I had was a pen. Initially, I thought, could I use this as a weapon? And I thought, yeah, but it doesn't match a buck knife. And so then I started writing because I didn't want to talk to him because it pissed me off, you know, he pissed me off. So I wasn't really engaging with him. So I'm starting to write. Then he rips the paper away from me to see what I'm writing.
Mm-hmm.
And that really bugged me. So when he put it down, I switched to German.
Wait a minute. So that pissed him off because he couldn't read it.
That pissed him off. And my German's horrible. You know, I mean, really.
But he didn't know any different, right?
He didn't know any different. It was horrible. But the funniest thing was I mentioned it because the sheriff later was like, okay, from the crime scene, we got what you wrote, but what the hell is this? Nobody can figure out what you're writing. Yeah,
it looks like, what do they call that from Egypt? It looks like
hieroglyphics.
Hieroglyphic. Yeah.
But I knew what German stuff. And then because I knew some Latin, I knew a little Spanish. If I couldn't figure the word in German, I'm like, oh, I picked it from a different language. So it was like, it was a gamish. It was a mess. Then it started getting dark, you know, like even though he put up all those papers, I knew it was nighttime. And I got taken hostage like at 10 a.m. and it's nighttime. And hours have gone by. And I'm thinking, everybody went home. It's a Friday. Everybody went home.
Fuck, I'm here all weekend now, right?
Let me here to die. And he had told them at midnight he wanted to be killed, shot through the door. He had put like a little, truly, he put a little bullseye on the outside of the door before he walked into my exam room. All sorts of weird stuff. Yes, yeah. And he goes, just shoot through the door. And I'm thinking, they can't shoot through the door. And then what if I'm there? You know, it's like really nutsy. So imagine they called my husband at work. So my poor husband went to, you know, one of the prison director's office where they would ask him, what happens? What do you think if we do this? What do you think if we'll do that? Da, 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 da. So my husband's like waiting all this time. He's like, give me a gun. I'll kill him because
no shit.
He was like a platoon leader. Right. And Clifton you know, Clifton told me, look, I killed people I had nothing against, you know.
And here's a guy I got some against. So,
right. So, but when it was getting close to midnight, and I thought, I'm never going to get out of here. Then what they had done is they had got a Reno SWAT team. And I don't know how they got that, but the Reno SWAT team had come to the prison. They were trying to figure out with my husband how to get me out and stuff. And then they told my husband, look, this is how we envision it. We're going to do this and that, but your wife could be deaf afterwards because we're throwing in, we're going to get in a
flashbang and all that.
Flashbang, concussion, whatever it was. So what they did was they knew the paper was up, but they had positioned outside these incredibly intense lights. So they, all of a sudden you're in the dark, then there's these bright lights hit the room. And, you know, I was like an animal. You just know something's happening.
I just
automatically dropped to the floor and was heading toward a corner when everything happened. So the lights hit, he grabbed the phone, which was their key. They sledgehammered a hole in, which is a kickout panel, you know, because there's a wall, but there's a supposed kickout panel or something. So they sledgehammered through the wall, threw in the grenade. And then when it went off, the whole room like expanded, you know. I mean, this is a cement room. It like expanded. And I'm looking at the door and it seems like the door's going out and then it's coming back in. And then I thought, this is the last thought in my head. And I thought, poor Cliff, my husband, poor Cliff. I never even gave him a baby because we were only married 2 years at that point in time, right? And I thought, that was the last, you know, I thought that was the last death, I mean, last thought in my head. And then the officers literally like almost pulled the door off the hinges. And they say, I don't know, there's like X amount of seconds you're so concussed you can't really do anything.
Yeah.
So I heard these I heard these little poppy sounds in the room. And at that moment it didn't click to me. They came in and they just blew them away a few feet from me.
Yeah. Halfway through your story, I'm like, death by cop. I see this death by cop. Like
that's what he was going for.
Yeah.
And, you know, he was too narcissistic to do suicide. You know, some guys do suicide. And what I did not know, which I found out much later, is he had envisioned he wanted to be killed at midnight because that would be the 14th year anniversary of him killing the cop. That would have been October 14th. Now, here's even weirder. My full name, Karen Ann Gedney, 14 letters in my name.
What?
Yes, yes. So now I found
genius.
Yes, I found out all of this later, you know, and it's like very weird, but that's
holy Jesus. So were you assaulted once during the time?
Yeah, just one rape. You know, it was like he had to do it, and then it was over, and it's like, oh thank God, that's over.
Yeah.
And that was it. Yeah.
How long did you work as the doctor in there? How many years?
A total of 30 years.
And that was your only time that you got?
That was my only time I was in a hostage situation.
Hostage. That's the word I was looking for.
I was hostage. Yeah.
Let's not, I mean, if we're doing math, the numbers is not too bad, right? I mean, that fucking sucks. I can't even imagine being in.
You know what sucked the worst, though? This is Friday. I go back to work on Monday. And
you went back to work on Monday.
Right. Now the prison. Yeah, right.
Okay. Right.
I go back to work on Monday. The prison in no way followed up with me at all.
You're like, okay. Oh, hey, welcome back. Sorry, right. Next.
Well, they didn't say anything. They ignored me. So I come in. So there's still a hole in the wall of my room. It is cold, right? There's a big hole in the wall. And then when I stepped, the blood gushed up from the tile, you know.
Holy shit.
And then there were bullet holes through the screen. You know how you have a screen?
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
hospitals were through that.
They didn't clean up or nothing.
Well, they cleaned up a little bit, you know, major blood, but not really clean, probably, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, they probably sent inmates in there just to mop it up.
They biohazard inmate team in, like, blood or something. I was like,
oh stepping on the...
Yeah, so when I came in, you know, I had major butterflies and major everything else.
Well, you just didn't come back to work and everything was fine? Come on. What?
And what I didn't know at the time was, I guess the prison director or the warden, somebody told staff, don't bother the doctor. But so no one talked to me. All right. Which is not good.
No.
Because it's the worst thing to do. It's sort of like, because then in my mind, I'm thinking they really want me dead. You see what I mean? Right?
So did you have a bad relationship with the guards like your whole term? I mean, did you ever?
No, I wouldn't say that. There were certain, to me, you know, I had no problem with the officers as long as they didn't give me a hard time. Right, you know. And there were a lot of officers. It's like a spectrum. You've got really, really good ones. And then guys that are just doing their job but don't want to be bothered. And then you have ones that are
an asshole
that should not be working in a prison.
Yeah.
And you only need a couple of those bad apples to affect the guys who are just slumping around, if you know what I mean.
100%. Yeah, yeah, I mean that is just nuts. And you could say that the way I look at that, you know, you could take any group of people, any race of people,
right?
Cops, right. Firemen, right. Nurses, teachers.
Yeah, doctors too. Whatever
group. I mean, any race, any group of people. There's assholes in every group.
Yes.
And you can't lump them in and think that the whole group is an asshole, but they do rot it pretty quick.
Right.
You know, as you would say, you got to cut the cancer out.
Yeah, woman. Yeah, but the interesting thing, actually, can I show you something?
Sure.
Let me see if I see.
I always like a little show and tell.
Yeah. Let me see if I've got it here.
So if you're listening to this on audio, I'll put a picture on my social media. You can go back and find it.
Yeah, because
what do we got?
I reached for something because I think it's worthwhile showing it to you. Oh, here we go. So imagine the staff don't say anything. Some don't know what to say, and then others, you know, just don't want to do anything. And the inmates were the ones who helped me heal. Okay.
Oh, all right. No shit. There's a spin.
Because they were like, hey, this is not acceptable. It's not acceptable. Like, hey, this is a doctor that cares about us. And okay, we know Moth Meller, but he wanted to die. He should have just offed himself, not do this to the doc, which is an asset to us. Okay.
Right.
So this, and you know, Meller was death row, right? And in life without. So watch this. You see this card here?
Wow, it's beautiful.
It's beautiful, right? And very, you notice, you know, the tear there and this and that.
The tear,
on my prison yard, all the lifers.
Holy shit.
You see, so that I kept it because what they wanted to show me, and see, they're not technically allowed to give me a card or anything, but somehow they got this to me, you know.
Yeah, well, and there's always a way.
There's always a way. And I wasn't going to tell custody on all my lifers, but the lifers made it very clear this is
not cool.
Not cool. And in fact, one of the lifers wrote a newspaper article that they published in the paper where he basically made the point, you know, that, wow, Meller wanted to die, but this he should have never done. And then on top of it, this affects all of us lifers, you know.
Yeah, right? Yeah. They got their code. You know, come on.
Right. They definitely have a convict code.
Yeah.
And so there's a whole hierarchy in the prison for that. And there were the majority of the guys, I really appreciated how much I tried to help them. And then there's some individuals where if you don't give them what they want, they're like a 3-year-old tantrum.
Yeah, I could see that.
that was also could happen.
So you you retired from that, or you just quit? Like, what? How did you get out of that?
Okay, so after, you know, I had to do the 4 years in the prison with the feds. So I'm 2 years in, so I have to stay another 2 years, irregardless. And then after I did my 4 year stint, I made the decision, hey, I'm very much needed here. And I always wanted to take care of the underserved.
Right.
And I sort of like fighting abuses of power. You know, I like that.
Oh, shit, man. You got all, man, you hit the trifecta.
Jackpot.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I hit the jackpot. And then I also liked getting a salary versus a business where you're,
I just
like that much better for me. Yeah, I mean, I didn't want to get rich. I just give me a salary and then let me be a doctor. If I need to spend 2 minutes with a person or 2 hours with a person,
doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter. But in the outside world, you can't do that.
Now is, at that point, were you're a employee of the state.
Yeah. Employee of the state. Right. And okay, then I've been a state employee for 30 years, basically.
So like medical, and you get all the benefits of being a state employee.
I get a wonderful state retirement, and that's a good thing because, you know, the docs in the outside world made a lot more money than I did, but they tended to also have a lot higher lifestyle, you see, right? So, and then marry the wrong nurses.
multiple nurses.
Right. So I'm very fortunate that I got a 30-year retirement. And so I just wanted to share that when I retired, I still wanted to help the inmates. And I thought the best thing is people remember stories. Like, that's why you like podcasts, because
I love good stories.
Right, you love good stories. And that's why I wrote my memoir, 30 Years Behind Bars, Trials of a Prison Doctor.
That's amazing.
Did you see the book at all?
No, not yet.
It's a good thing I got my shelf. See, look, there it is, 30 Years Behind Bars.
That's amazing. I like the simplicity. I like the simplicity of the cover.
Yeah, and you see the contact where it's basically you got the barbed wire, but
yeah,
the light. But there's also something I really want to show you in this book. Every chapter starts with artwork from one of the inmates. And God, where is that now? Post moth. So one of the chapters, of course, has to do with moth, you know, the guy who took me.
Of course. Hostage, now, right? let me ask you on that. Was there any repercussion? What's the word I'm looking for? Anything that you got for that, like later in your years, or that was just gone and you moved on and ever?
You mean PTSD or something, or no?
No, not, any compensation from the state or anything? Nothing.
But here, watch this, Walter. So you see this artwork?
Holy shit.
Okay. So what happened is the artist knew Moth very well.
Now, does that look like him?
Well, the thing is, you can see that when I first looked at the artwork he did, I thought, oh my God, he gave him horns. That's a moth on his face.
Yeah, yeah. No, I see the moth, and it goes along the side of his cheeks and his mouth.
Right,
I can see that.
Right, yeah.
But like his eyes and his nose and shit, does that look like
him? Yeah, that's the same. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
He looks like that? Or he looks like that? Oh, that's fucking creepy.
Right.
That's amazing. That's amazing artwork.
Well, and so every chapter is done by this inmate, Ismail Santillanes, and Izzy... he was called Izzy, did 27 years in the prison. So he was there all the years I was. And when I wrote the book, and the person, like, I self-published, but I had someone do the formatting stuff, which I don't know how to do. And then the person who did the formatting said, hey, you know, every chapter is like could stand by itself. And they said, and it's so emotional and visual in my mind. What do you think about putting a picture for each chapter? And initially I thought, what is this? It's not going to be a comic book or something.
No,
but then I thought, about the inmates, and Izzy is one of the better artists, really a great artist. And he was in the outside world, so I had a contact number, because the poetry teacher, who I know, who taught poetry and writing and art and everything, he became a mentor for this guy and created a GoFund site for him to get his master's degree in creative writing and fine arts.
That's beautiful.
Right? That's a great story.
That's awesome.
And so I had the contact info. So I contacted Izzy. I said, look, Izzy, what do you think? You know all my lifetime in the prison.
Yeah.
Because he also was one of my clerks. He worked for me too. So he knew.
Oh, that's cool.
In one of my programs. And I said, look, Izzy, I'm going to give you just a paragraph on each chapter. And could you read the paragraph? You know what's going on. And just give me artwork at that emotional level. Oh my God, he did a great job.
He knocked out just that one.
30 pieces of art. And I paid him for each one. So he got a chunk of money.
Oh,
he helped him out.
Well, that's cool. You know, that's cool. Because I believe that you, as a creative, you should be paid or compensated of some kind.
Definitely.
But if that's an example of what he did, man, that's amazing. Amazing.
Yeah.
I do want to touch on real quick. We're running out of time.
Yeah.
But I do want to touch out real quick.
Yeah.
You got to tell me what you did after.
Okay.
You got to touch this with me. Yeah. I saw that picture. I'm like, son of a bitch.
Yeah. So after the prison, you know, I wrote the book, but I also got another degree in medicine called Aging Well. And then when I would give talks, there was a lady told me who said, hey, Karen, you know, I'm competing in bikini and fitness and this and that. And I've got this, trainer, and, you know, you could be with me and then you could compete in Ultra Masters, which is the 60 to 70 year old group. This is a couple of years ago. And I was like, bikini. God, she talked me into it. And then I'm one of those people who I like challenges. And of course that's like so out of my world. But I have a good physique because like I'm a gym rat. Right?
Yeah. Oh, right. I'm with you.
Like I'm a gym rat. And so that was a whole funny, I don't know, time because, you know, they're like, okay, you got to wear this sparkle thongy thing. And it's like, oh my God, I put it on backwards. I was like, this doesn't work. I didn't know what I was doing. And then all the other way around, I'm like, oh. And it's like, you know, so
I put it on backwards. That's awesome.
The first time I was like, this is so little, which way does this go? And so you got this blue sparkly thing on. And then when you compete, you know, they spray paint you. They put all the makeup on you. They wanted you to be in high heels, but yeah, high heels, super high heels don't work for me because my feet don't want to be in them. So I got a lower heel for myself. And then, you know, I mean, I have, you know, long blonde hair still, you know, I'm like almost 70 now and I still got it. And
right.
So that was flowing up behind my back. Oh my God. I won, you know, that's the other thing.
That's odd. State level?
Well, this was in Las Vegas. It was called, what is that thing called? USA Championships ICN. You know, they had
ICN.
You know, yeah. They got all these weirdo ones.
Yeah, out. Yeah.
Right. Yeah. But first place was up on my wall.
Damn. How long did you train for?
Well, with her, probably 4 or 5 months. That's all I did because, it's not like I had to lose weight or really get in shape. I had to learn the moves and stick out your butt. And
the posing is.
The poses. That was sort of annoying to me. But
how long did you do that for?
I did it once. She wants me to do it again, but it's like, I don't want to do it again. So she.
You went out on a high note.
Yeah, I went out on a high note. Well, that was the first place that was good enough for me, you know.
That's awesome.
Maybe, you know, then there's, what is it? Supreme Ultra Masters is 70 to 80. I don't know. It's a possibility I could maybe do that too, but maybe. That's a maybe.
I think you'll do it. I'm just going to throw that out there. That is awesome. So here you are, to recap, here you are 30 years in the prison system.
Right, yeah.
Female doctor, all male prisons, of course.
Yes.
And then, you know, the stories we talked about. And then you're like, I'm going to write a book, you know, which is cool. And that's got to be therapeutic to begin with, right?
It was great psychotherapy for
me. Yeah.
It really was. I had to change all the names.
Of course.
If you know the prison, you go, oh, I know who that is.
Yeah, I was going to say, people that know the prison were reading that and like, I know that motherfucker.
Yeah.
And then your friend is like, hey, let's get into the bodybuilding competition. And you're like, I might as well do that. That's amazing. Win first place at fucking I'm out, drop mic. And here you are talking to me. That's amazing.
And I want to just end with three little things, just so you know, because I still want to help the inmates. I sit on the Nevada Prison Education Project to actually really help the system get more college education. In fact, in the fall, I'll go back in the prison and teach psychology 101 through one of the community colleges. Number two, there's something called Return Strong. That's a big organization in Nevada, which is formed by a union lady who takes the incarcerated families that have all the issues with their loved ones in prison and the incarcerated. And I help them out talking before legislators regarding bills that need to be passed to actually make things more just in the prison and less problematic. So she's really pushed through a number of bills because she's got 2,000 people with her, see?
Mm-hmm,
but
mm-hmm.
Since I have a unique voice, I can say, you know, I'm not like a mother of a kid. I can say, I was the prison doctor for 30 years. And then the legislators, you know, are like, whoop. You know,
Yeah. You're just not like an activist.
No. I'm a different type of activist. And then I also sit on the Ridge House, which is residential housing for inmates in Reno with substance abuse help and getting jobs and things. So I sit on the board for that because that's an important organization. So I'm still trying to help, you know, the guys.
Yeah, of course.
That I love just a totally different way.
Well, the thing is, though, from doing your 4 years, sounding weird talking about prison,
right,
but doing your 4 years, and then you wanted to come back. Sure, you had a little bit of motivation and were like, I don't want to go into private practice. I want to, you know, state salary, right, basically. But your main motivation, your passion is to help people. So
yeah,
now
help people. Right.
I'm going to be put, I've already gone through some shit, but you know what? I find purpose here, people, I'm helping people.
Right.
And that's just so, you know, it's amazing to find people like you in the world, you know, and that's why I like talking to people like this. Cause you go through some shit, but you're like, you know what? I'm doing much better and I'm doing better work. Like, something happened to me. I get it. I'm dealing with it. I do my thing, but look at what I can do for everybody else. That's cool. That's super cool. Very inspiring.
Yeah, because I think most people who have gone through weird things or trauma like that, the worst thing is they never get out of the victim mentality. And to me, it's you have to pivot and see what you can do that's good out of it. So for me, one, it's a story, but it's also to be able to talk about forgiveness because, you know, the prison is not a place a lot of people forgive people.
Yeah, that's not a forgiving place to begin with. Yeah.
And you know, and people will go, well, I mean, I had staff that would say, I'm never going to forgive a child molester. You see what I mean? Right?
Because
they had a child who was molested or they were molested or whatever. And the thing is, when you take care of me, taking care of child molesters, you know, they've been usually victimized when they were a kid, then they come in prison and then they're victimized again by everybody.
And so it
sort of reminds me of the early days when gay men were basically thrown into prisons because they had a whole different sexual orientation. Now that's changed, but so many of those guys were thrown away as children.
And, well, we could.
Yeah. And you could go on forever with the
Yeah, I was just going to say we could go on forever about that conversation. But what I want to do is hand over the mic to you for a minute. Okay. Let people yeah. know. It's been a long day. Let people know where to find you. And, you know, your little elevator pitch, as we used to call it back in the sales days.
Right, right. Yeah.
And then, so go ahead, let people know what's going on.
So I think people have to know that I am in the prison reform activist arena, but I'm also in the aging well arena because I worry about the demographics in the U.S. and I want to keep myself still frisky as I get older.
That's good for the old man, too.
That's right. Yeah, my husband passed away.
I'm sorry.
You know, after I retired, he ended up passing away. He was a bodybuilder too. And nowadays, I think the biggest thing to, if you want to contact me, is discoverdrg.com. That's my website, and on it is basically author, speaker, and I'm a medical expert witness as well for the correctional world. And there you can see all sorts of different things on there. And that's the best place to look. And if you want my book on Amazon, it's Amazon, but I did the Audible. So some people just like to listen.
That's right.
So I did the Audible on this. And if people are interested in contacting me, I'll give you my email, because I like to speak on prison reform, but I also like to speak on aging well, you know, from the medical side. And my email is kgedneymd@gmail.com.
Cool. Well, I'll put both links in the show notes.
Right.
So people can just go click directly to it.
Yeah, that'd be great. But yeah, email is the way I like to get contacted.
And awesome.
Then look at the website.
No social media links?
You know,
I tagged you tonight.
Yeah, yeah. I have a Facebook one, but you know, I put intermittent things on the Facebook, and it's really just about the prison. I'm not I'm not the social type, because you know, in the prison, they did not want you socially connected in the outside world because I'm too much of a high risk for hostage taking and stuff like that.
Oh, God damn. Right? All right. So that kind of.
Right. So I never, and I have a LinkedIn thing too, but.
Okay.
Those things are, I'm like a dinosaur in that area. That's not one of my things. I like to be in person. You know.
Yeah, well, same here, but you know how the world works.
Right.
All right. Well, Karen, we got to get out of here.
Yes.
But hang tight for a second. Much appreciate it. I love the stories. You know,
I went off on different.
That's the whole point. That's the whole point of conversation. I hate a timeline stuff. All right. Hang tight. Thanks again for coming on.
Okay.
Well, you can't say Karen hasn't been through it, and she's got this awesome book out that outlines everything, and it's an Audible for people like me that consume information a lot better that way. But a link is in the show notes for her book, and make sure you reach out to her. I bet you she would love to talk to you about it. All right, man, I'm going to get you out of here because I know you got shit to do, but don't forget, composure, live Rishi, high speed daddy, and my website. All right, man, till next time, keep kicking ass.
You out there? You listening?